Last week we started, I want to welcome everybody once again. We started the series of discussion on validity and reliability. The first day we gave an overview. The second day we explained, we dwelt much on reliability. Today we'll quickly go over validity. I think we'll finish the discussion today. But next tomorrow, we still talk about diagnostic test. So it's an extension of form of validity. But next tomorrow will be on diagnostic test. We'll quickly look at validity. But before we move on, we discussed extensively about reliability. But we talk about the different type. And if you see the slide I'm showing, it's one of the slides I show on reliability. But I just want to discuss something in addition. If you look at the four major types, which each of them also has a subtype. We have the test, retest, scoring, agreement. We have equivalent form and internal consistency. For the scoring agreement, we talk about inter-rater and inter-rater. There is other one, we talk about agreement of which you can use in the situation where the variable you are measuring is quantitative. You are using method. You have two methods to measure the quantitative variable. In that situation, you can, it is recommended to use what we call Bland-Hackman plot, to explain instead of, use correlation to establish reliability, to measure the reliability, is better to use Bland-Hackman's plot. Bland-Hackman's plot, was introduced by Martin Bland and Douglas Hackman some years ago. They published their paper in Lancet, and they described agreement between two quantitative variables. They established a method, this method, of agreement between two quantitative measurements by constructing limit of agreement. What you mean by limit of agreement is that when you use two methods to measure a particular variable, you may not actually get all the time get similarity. So the difference now will be the bias in the agreement. So the disagreement now, the word actually say limit of agreement. It's a misnomer. It will be limit of disagreement because the difference in the measurement now. So what is the limit? So they actually set the difference can follow normal distribution also. They now set mean to 95% confidence level for the difference. So that anything beyond the 95% is believed to be different. But within the 95% confidence level, it's believed that they are still measuring the same thing. And it's very straightforward, but it's not actually a statistic because you cannot actually bring one new statistic out. But the statistic that actually corresponds to that is pair t-test. If you do pair t-test, you'll be able to see, establish the fact that, okay, this difference in the two measurement or in the reading, the two method is actually statistically significant. The essence of the Bland-Hackman is to have a mental picture of it, to plot. When you plot, what they do recommend is to plot the difference at the y-axis and the average between the two reading. That is, you add the reading from the two method together and divide by two, giving you average. So, the average now represent the value, the actual value. So the logic behind is as you move along as the value increases, what happened to the difference? So if you plot the difference at the vertical axis and the average at the horizontal axis, as you move towards the right, if the average is increasing, if the value of the average increases like that, what happened to the difference? Is there any? So if you look at it, you see the plots, that's the plot I'm showing you. The middle of the plot is the mean of the difference. If perfectly is the same reading. The mean, or in some situation, the mean will be zero. If you look at the middle of the graph is zero. Then in this case now, the mean just a little bit above zero. So the mean should be around that zero, not too far from it, if it's actually the same. Then they now describe the limit of agreement. Apart from the establishing the mean, the 1.96 standard deviation, you calculate the standard deviation of the mean, of the difference. And you now have 1.96, that's approximately two standard deviation away. You add the mean minus 1.96 standard deviation, and the mean plus 1.96 standard deviation. So the one below the mean now, the zero, will be the mean minus 1.92 standard deviation, standard deviation, while the line above is mean plus 1.96 standard deviation. So it is believed that mean minus 1.96 standard deviation between the mean minus 1.96 standard deviation and the mean plus 1.926 standard deviation constitute the limit of the agreement. So anything below it, you will see in this graph now, most of the dots, the measurement are within the limit of agreement. The plus or minus and plus 1.92 standard deviation, most of them. If you look at it, in fact, if you look at the reading now, it is when, because this one is on hemoglobin, it's trying to look at bilirubin measurement with different methods, using serum bilirubin or transcutaneous bilirubin. So if you, the vertical axis is the difference between the transcutaneous and serum bilirubin, while the horizontal axis is the average between of the two reading, which is representing the value, the average of the two reading. Now, if you look at it now, it is when you look at the average up to 150 here, you cannot see any point outside the limit of agreement. But it is after the 150, you begin to see some up both above and below. It's after 150, you begin to see one outside. That means that what this one is saying is that when the measurement, what that particular building is around 150, below 150. In fact, all the reading from the two methods are within the limit of agreement. It is when the value is above 150 that you see some outside. That's just the explanation. So when you in a situation where all of them are within, that should that they are all within the limit of the agreement. Now, if persistently a method is higher than the other one, maybe the value from one method is persistently higher than the other one, what will happen is that the graph, all of them will be above zero or below zero, depending on which one did you remove from which. So it's either it is above zero or all of them are below zero. So once you see something like that, should have one is either persistently above, one is higher, that's the difference. So, normally when you are saying you are measuring, you are using two methods. In some situation, method A may be higher than method B. In some situation, B may be higher than A. In some situation, they will have the same value. So that's the situation what you are seeing now. Then if in a situation, persistently, one method is higher than the other one, you will not see, you will see the point will be above zero or below the zero, depending on which one to remove from the other. That's just it. So this one we have, because the logic behind using, recommending Blank-Hartmann plots instead of correlation in that situation is because it's possible two things correlate, they don't agree. So for the fact that two things agree may not mean they correlate. Like for example, for correlation has no unit. You can correlate anything. You can correlate even reading and the age. So are they on the same? They are not on the same scale. And they can correlate very well. Two things that are not even related can correlate very well. So if you now plot two things that are even related, for the fact that they correlate does not mean that the reading agree. And that is the argument the people that invented this one put forward. And that is why it's good. But the issue there.
Please, sir, we cannot hear you, sir. Hello, sir. We can't hear you at all.
Okay, sorry. Can you hear me now? Sorry, when the team went out. Sorry. Can you hear me now? Can you hear now?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah,
sir.
Sorry.
Yes, yes. Can hear you out,
oh, sorry. When the team went out, yeah, I think the now muted me. I didn't notice that. Sorry. Okay. Where the team, what I was saying was that one condition that must be met in using Black Atma is that the two things, the two measurements, though you are measuring the same thing, two true methods, but they must have the same unit. You know, sometimes you can have two things that are measuring the same thing, but they don't have the same unit of measurement. So they must have the same unit, because if they don't have the same unit, you cannot compare, because it is different. You cannot remove minus something from the other one that have the same unit. You cannot calculate average for two things that don't have the same unit. So they must have the same unit before you can use Black Atma. But for correlation, they don't need to have the same unit. It just, once they are quantitative, because correlation by its nature is a ratio, it has cancelled out unit. It's not affected by the unit of measurement. And that is a good aspect of correlation. But the issue here now is only a situation that Black Atma will replace correlation. You know, there are some situations where you even have that some special measure of reliability, like current kappa. We have a Cronbach alpha. These are for measuring internal consistency. You notice that this method, they are special form of correlation. They are actually correlation, but they are special form because they will not have positive negative value. Because correlation can be negative or positive. But for reliability, you cannot have negative. So you see now, that was why some of those people, the intelligent people, they invented those methods. But the assessor is not all the situation. No, the method of reliability depends on the context. So it's some context that you can have, like the one you use kappa for. It's not all the situation you can use kappa for. Then internal consistency is the correct kappa is internal consistency. It doesn't measure other aspect of reliability. So you can see, even this Black Atma now is only limited to quantitative measurement. When you are having two methods of measuring, or more than one method of measuring a particular thing, you cannot do it for test retest, because test retest is the same thing you measure two times. But this one is two methods of measuring. Maybe if you are talking about parallel form, you can use this one, because in parallel form, it's two methods of measuring the same thing, but they must have the same unit. So you see that the Black Atma is there in situation that can fulfill this condition. In situation where they cannot fulfill the condition, you still have to use reliability. So you see that in the situation that is not internal consistency, is non current kappa, you cannot use Black Atma, you may still have to use correlation as measure of reliability. So I think that is just that. We go to validity, but that's the discussion for today. So validity, as we said in the first day, is the degree to which a method is able to prove or measure what is said to measure. If you say you are measuring, it's like you have a weighing scale, you bring it, you say you are measuring weight, and maybe somebody that is naturally 70 stand on it, he measure 90. The person that is 80 will measure 100. And if you guys not take a bill, you just be taking, it's 100 kg. This one is 70 kg. For us, it's hardening 10, 20. It's not valid. It's not actually, even you can write it as weight, but that's not the weight. It's not actually measuring what it's supposed to measure. So that just on a lighter note, but in some situation, your validity can even apply to the whole study. You may carry out a study and you conclude and even go to a talk, and whereas what you got is far from what is there. So that shows your study is not valid, but you may not know. So the method, it may be that the invalidity of that study may be because the method is not valid. The method you use or instrument you use to capture data, well, it was not valid. Or maybe some other things also, the old method, the design, make it not to be valid. So validity has to do with the ability of your method to measure what you set to measure. Just like reliability also, the approach to it depends on the context, there are different contexts. So there are situations, different situations will warrant different methods. And what they now call type of validity, actually, the people that first describe it, they didn't describe it as type. They actually describe it as approaches. The issue there is that there are different contexts. So for each context, you approach it in a spectacular way that you feel will solve the problem. That is me. That is why they approve better. Over the years, people now say type of validity. There's no actually validity. They are just approaches to validity in for different contexts. Now, you are familiar with some of those approaches, phased validity and content validity. In some literature, in some text, they will write it as both of them, they classify both of them as translational validity. And well, the reason is that what is we have talked about phased validity is the ability of that tool to actually to address the different aspects, common trend, pointing to common trend. If you say you are measuring quality of life, is all these two, what the question you ask there, is he talking about quality of life or is talking about perception? Because you somebody talking about quality of life and the question is asking about perception or attitude. So the degree to which these two, all the element of the two are measuring what they are supposed to common trend, that particular thing you want to measure, attribute you want to measure, that is the phase validity. And who knows that? There's no way to do that except for an expert to read and say, okay, this question you want to put here is not talking about quality of life, it's talking about perception. So that is why, how do you establish it? You give it to an expert in that field that will look at the two and say, okay, all these items, they are talking about the subject matter. The same thing with content validity. The only difference in the content validity is trying to see that these different items that form these two, they cover the whole universe of the thing you want to study. And for example, in every study or anything you want to measure, there's scope. So sometimes, maybe you're talking of quality of life, talking about different dimensions of quality of life. You say there's social dimension, psychophysical dimension, psychological dimension, environmental, social dimension, many things like that. So even now, they say there's spiritual dimension to the quality of life. Now, if your question, you exhaust all dimensions, it now remains spiritual dimension. That should that it has not covered all the aspects. So the extent to which the instrument now cover all the scope, the every part of what you are measuring is the content. That is the content. You exhaust all the different aspects of what you are measuring. And is this in the same way you carry out phase validity? Is the expert that look at it and say, okay, it has touched all the different aspects. No one is excluded. So you can see that is why that was why the people that classify both of them under one umbrella as translational validity. Translational, maybe what they mean by translational, is it that because those people translate it to all, maybe it's another context. Maybe they call it translational because they feel that for you to know that what is measured, you want to measure is measured. The tool has captured it, translate. It has covered everything because you use the tool to capture the data from those people. So now, another approach you want to look at is the criterion validity. In criterion validity now, what we are now looking at is that, okay, that particular thing you want to measure. Apart from the fact you can see, you can do content validity, phase validity. It doesn't say that, it doesn't mean that by the time you administer the tool, it will even capture it will actually measure what you're supposed to measure. Something will, you may have a tool, this tool will do this work. Yes, I can see the way the tool is, you will do the work. And you may apply the tool, you may not do the work. So, how do you know that this tool is measuring what is supposed to measure? There must be something you are comparing, like a gold standard. There must be something that is measuring. They call that particular the proof, a criterion. There must be a criterion that you want to use, you want to compare you, what your truth has captured with. And that criterion is defined by a gold standard. So for it will be even easy for you to understand you in medical profession. For example, now, if you want to know if pap smear, does it actually peak the early diagnosis of cervical cancer? Does it actually do that? Because that's what they say it does. It's, you know, it's able to pick cervical cancer at the early stage so that you can now prevent. But how will you know? The two is the criterion will be provided by a gold standard, which is the biopsy. Biopsy is the criterion because biopsy will be, the pathology will be able to tell you, okay, this is the differentiation in the cell. There's a change in the cell, and this is the degree of the change. So biopsy is the standard for that. So that one is, is very simple to conceptualize. There are many things also in medicine like that, it's pathology that give us the last say. There must be something that will be the gold standard. But in social science, it's not as easy as that because it's a concept. It's very fluid. So the gold standard also, well, the gold standard here may be another tool that they have been proven to measure that thing. Maybe we are talking of perception or quality of life now. Maybe quality of life of people living with tuberculosis. Maybe there's one standard tool that they have been using and that has been proven that it measures the quality of life of those who that live with tuberculosis. You now have a new one that you want to compare. Okay. So that one is that criterion validity. There are two aspects now. What is it, two or three aspects of it? Here it comes. One, if by the time you are measuring, you are capturing your own data, you can also capture the criterion at the same time. Like it can happen in the cancer we are talking about. You can take pap smear and do biopsy at the same time for the same person, and you get the result and you now compare them. But there are some that it will be concurrent. The name concurrent at the same time, concurrent validity. So if you can take biopsy, you can take the pap smear at the same time. If it is questionnaire also, you administer this questionnaire, the one that is go standard, you administer both of them at the same time to the same set of people and compare and correlate their results. That is concurrent. But there are some situations where that criterion that may serve as the proof of that thing, you cannot get it now. It will be in future because, for example, if you are talking about examination to university, use JAMB and SSC to determine who is capable of being the student of university. So the score, so they said that anybody that's best score very high in WAEC and JAM, you can be sure it will be easy for them to get admission to the course they want to. It will be easier for them compared with people that did score very high. Trying to say that the people that score very high is good, they are satisfied, they have the requirement. So to actually prove that these people that score higher, they are actually better than the other one, the view that has gone lower. The proof is will be in future. It's not now. It will be done just by, because some people can cram something overnight and it will be rolling their head and they'll point it out the following day and they will pass. Whereas some people, they are good. They have residual knowledge, but maybe that residual knowledge overnight will not, score high like the other people. Give the impression that this is, and whereas the person that scored lower may be better in that thing. So in future is in the school now, their grades may be. So in future, after they've gotten the admission, when they now start exam, their grade in the university will determine. Now you can now go. You can get people's grade in university and now get their JAM results and SSC results and see. Maybe the people that are higher are still higher. That would be predictive because the result, the job result is the tool you want to validate. So that type of validity is because you can only predict the criterion. You cannot measure the criterion immediately. If you can measure the criterion, of course, you will not admit, in fact, you even admit some people that score lower because you have already validated and it's gone. No, this one are better. This one is called higher. We don't know. But you cannot do that. It is after they have entered, they have started that you can validate. So it's predictive validity. There are some situation also where you, what you are validating, you know, in this one, the criteria now is in the, is in the future. But the criteria is in the past. Okay, just like somebody that have a cardiac infarction, and you now start to get some enzyme, troponin or creatinine kinase, to measure in the blood to see if, because they believe that during the infarction, those things are released. But the criteria is that the patient have a myocardial infarction. But the, if you want to see the validity of creatinine kinase, is it actually measuring myocardial infarction? If you take sample of people and now begin to, you know, you measure their creatinine kinase. For you to, what will validate it as happened? You can only thing you can ask the history. Did this person have infarction before? Did they have infarction? Can you see now? So the criterion is in the past, unlike the predictive, that the criterion is in the future. But this one, the criterion is in the past, and I call it predictive validity. Now, that is an aspect now, when we talk about the criterion validity. Now, the another aspect approach is what we call construct. This is the most difficult to evaluate. It's the most difficult because the word construct just means something hidden. Construct means Latin variable. Latin, even some people don't even call it crazy. It's just a concept. It's a concept. Even if you know it, because the reason they don't call it a variable is that the concept, there are many variables that may measure the concept. And now you talk about depression or happiness. It's a concept. So somebody, have you seen happiness? Okay, somebody is laughing. He's enjoying, he's bubbling, he go for recreation, he's throwing party. You see, he's happy. Or you ask question, have you ever even contemplated community suicide? Have you done it? No, God forbid. So in that sense, this person is happy. So you only measure happiness by something you think is related to happiness. And those ones are the variable you can substantiate, you can measure. That is why some people don't call it the construct variable. It just is a concept. But to me, for you to understand it better, you can, even if it's a variable, it's a hidden one. It's a latent things you want to, a variable. In the sense that you remember, you know, of latent, something that is hidden, it's difficult to perceive. Like you remember latent heat of fission, you know, at the when temperature of ice block increases, it will reach 0 degree. At that 0 degree, until all the heat supply melts the something, it will not increase further. That you think as if you put the thermometer there, it will be zero. So until it will remain zero until the thing gets, it's not as if it is not being supplied. It is being supplied better. That is it. The heat is hidden. It's used for something, it doesn't come out. It's the same thing. If you are boiling water, you put your temperature, your thermometer. It will be rising until it reaches 100 degrees centigrade. It will not move above 100 degrees centigrade until all the water go off. Because the heat that is being supplied is being used for evaporation. It's not being recorded. It's hidden. It's latent. And that's why they call it latent heat. Now, the variable construct is latent in the sense that you cannot easily measure. You only measure what you think is related to it. Now, having explained that, you now said, okay, the different aspect of the latent, how can you now, if you want to validate a true quality of life, depression, on happiness, on percent, or many things that, that are hidden, how do you validate? You can only do that, one, if you have similar tool that have been used before. So it may not necessarily be a gold standard, but it has been established that it's doing the same thing. So you can now apply that your own and that one. If the score, you correlate it, the correlate, that show that it's convergent, call it convergent validity. That is, it's able to converge because they are doing the same thing. They are agreeing, more like they have agreed now. It shows that, okay, if it has been established that, okay, that particular tribe was mentioning the quality of life, that particular tribe. You can believe they strongly correlate. This one is mentioning it also. That's convergent validity. But if it's, you know, it doesn't correlate, that is divergent. And that one, well, it's not divergent like that. The divergent is when you now bring another to that, you know, that is measuring something else. The opposite, it doesn't measure. You try to look at it. Or, okay, you bring, if you bring it and it's not able to, if you bring that one, the other two that's not measuring the same thing, you now bring it and they don't correlate. That is divergent validity. Now, you can see another approach is to, if you have another group which is established that this group has been validated, they have this attribute. They have this group, they have this attribute. And now you are mentioning, that we mentioned in them that they have. You want to compare, you now have a group, you feel have the attribute. Maybe both of them were. You now want to compare the group with this other group. You use the two. And if the two, the score on both sides is the same, that should have proved that, okay, it's measuring it because both of them are similar group. They are similar, you know that these two group are similar group. Now bring these two and the two group. And you now see that both group, the result are the same, there's no difference. So that is a form of non-group. If it is a separate group also that is, doesn't have the attribute, you expect the result to be different. You are using non-group validity. Now, this convergent, the discriminant, sorry, that's one I call divergent. The discriminant, convergent, discriminant, and non-group, they are example of internal construct validity. It's different from internal validity. Because we still talk about that internal validity. It's quite different from internal validity. It's internal construct validity. Because this construct validity, as you see them, so if you look at the example, convergent, discriminant, and non-group, you are trying to look at the people that have this attribute. Now, there are some situations also you can look for similar attribute. It's not the same attribute like if you look at anxiety now, anxiety and depression. They are related somehow. So you may say, okay, if these two, this group anxiety and this group depression, you want to measure depression, and you now administer the two to both people that have, the two that's measuring anxiety and your own two. Your own two want to measure anxiety. And you now bring a two that's measuring depression. You administer to the same people. You expect them to correlate very well. That is a form of external construct validity. Why it is external is because you are trying to compare the attribute with another similar attribute. It is not the same, but you feel that they are related. And there are many attributes, and they call it external construct validity or nomological validity. But in some situations, there are many external attribute that can be related. All of that can be related. In that form, a network, call it nomological network. I think I have something like that. Okay, look at it. Nomological network, where you have anxiety, control, nervous, irritable sleep. So all those things, that is network, because you see many attributes that are common. They are common to different, so they are actually related. So sometimes when you want to validate two, you can pick anyone from the network. And if there's a tool that is measuring anyone from the network, even though it may not be 100% correlated, better issue level of correlation, not that the correlation will be too low. Somehow, the correlation should be substantial, showing that they are pointing to the same direction or they are related. That's an example of external control. Now, if you remember, I talked about the validity can be applied to, when you're talking of validity, to the instrument you're using. It can even be applied to the whole study. So sometimes when you want to look at the whole study holistically, it's not even limited to a particular method now. The whole study will be, and the context which you are doing the study at the time, you can classify validity into internal and external, which is different from internal construct validity, because that one is a form of construct validity and external construct validity. But this one, validity generally internal and external. So when you carry out a study and that study is valid, that is whatever is that's measured is actually valid for the group you even study. Because sometimes you can bring out this finding in some finding, and it may not even be true for the study, even the sample you study. So that type of study lacks internal validity. So, and that one is easily, you can easily do that, especially if you do regression. If you do regression and you talk about maybe linear regression, you talk about R squared, and that's okay, you develop a model. So you develop a model. You can now pick some of the even the sample, the participant. In the sample you study, you can pick some value out of the independent variable and try to see how it will predict the dependent variable for that person. So if you do that, I now see that there's a gap in what you want to catch. It's not valid. It's not even valid for the group you even study. That is, it lacks internal validity. That's just one way. So it lacks internal validity. But that's one aspect. You can pick the same, you can look at the same study and see how does it, is it even applicable to the immediate environment as per the population which you sample for. That is population validity. For example, when they wanted to code, now somebody will do a study in the Southeast, and maybe this person did it in Aba market, and I conclude that it has found out that the women, the market people in the Southeastern Nigeria are likely to do this. Southeastern Nigeria, that is 5 states. But this person did this work in Aba. All the markets in Aba that the person did the work in, and is now extrapolated to the South. That is a form of population. Inference now. It's drawing inference to the population. If the study is not even valid internally, how can it be valid externally? Then it can be valid internally. It may not be valid externally to the population. It is when the study is valid to the population that it will be good to do that type of inference. So if it's not even true beyond the people who study, so quoting that type of work to represent the whole of a region is a futility. Sometimes also, you can extrapolate the study will be valid even up to beyond that immediate population to some other places that, ecologically are the same or socially in many respects. Like for example, you can do study here now, and it may be valid in Ghana because we are Africa. There may be some social content that may be the same in Africa. So that is why sometimes when you cannot get a reference for your study in Nigeria, you can use Africa in case if the work has a good external validity. That's what we call a ecological validity. When it's beyond the immediate population, then go to other contexts, social contexts. That's ecological validity. So both population and ecological validity, they are subset of external validity. So when you talk about internal, external can be population or ecological validity. I think all this we have in the table, we have already, like for this slide, now just talking about how to do this concurrent validity. Like now, prostate cancer based on PSA. If you want to, maybe sometimes people use, rectal examination to diagnose prostate cancer. The gold standard, it will be PSA. So, because for the diagnosis of prostate cancer, whatever method you want to use, you use the criterion, the gold standard. So you can do it at the same time concurrently as the form. Then predictive college graduate based on Saturday. That's what I just said, like maybe jam based on the performance in school. Even sometimes you can even validate the university result, because you can see some people, In some institutions, it's easy to get first class, second class, and you. In some institutions, it's not easy to get. Or it may, some courses also, it may be easy to get. In some, it may not be easy to get. You may see that when you come out, you say, you even have second class upper, first class, they'll be rating you. Does that mean that this first class person is better than the third class person, or better than the second class lower? It may not necessarily be. If by time professionally they are working in their profession, let's see. Because the examination itself is not even a truth. So the validity of most is questionable. It's questionable. You discover that skill-wise, the people that score lower in a particular academic field may even be better when it comes to skill than the person that score higher. So you may validate predictive validity of the university. No, like we need to be doing it in our own environment here. Predictive validity of our university graduate. So that when they are working, let's refer back to where they are coming from to see, especially when they just start working. Not when they have already got another degree, you have sent them for some other training, but when they just start, let's see the predictive validity of the university they are coming from. So now, postdictive, I have said it before, creatinine kinase, troponin, or myocardial refraction. So then, yes, concurrent, predictive. That's what I think I've discussed all of them. I think we'll stop here because that's all. By tomorrow, and next tomorrow, we'll be discussing diagnosis test. So the diagnosis test is going to be two aspects. We have we'll be able to finish it tomorrow. We have the reference interval and the criterion validity of diagnosis test. So when we are talking of this criterion validity now, in the real work, how do you do that? The issue of sensitivity, specificity. So I think we'll stop here. Any question? If anybody, I think there are some chats. Good evening, please. We cannot hear. Yeah, okay, that was there. Please, I did not understand the explanation for the external construct validity and nomological. Please, what are the example errors people make in their research study methodology that can cause lack of internal validity apart from using a wrong questionnaire? Okay. So even this design, study design. Okay, the question, nomological validity is the same thing as external construct. External construct. What you just do there is that you are trying to compare, you know, you have a tool you want to validate, but that tool is trying to measure a construct. You now look for other related constructs. It's not the same construct. I give an example. Anxiety is a construct because you cannot diagnose anxiety and say, oh, the anxiety level and see it in laboratory. It's not objective. When we turn on the test, so the anxiety is 30%. No, it doesn't work like that. So it's this psychiatry that come with some question. They now say the person, when they do their scoring, they say you have anxiety. So the same thing with depression. You cannot measure it in laboratory. So is it that we administer some treatment and say somebody has bipolar depression? So depression, anxiety, somehow they are related because people that have anxiety may have depression, or vice versa. So they are somehow related. So if you have a tool that want to measure anxiety, anxiety is a construct. You can try to apply it together with the tool that measure depression together at the same time to people. So to see if they are scoring in the same direction. So that is nomological validity. It's external construct validity because the construct you are validating, the tool you are using to now validate is not measuring the same construct, it's measuring related construct. And those related construct, because there are plenty, it may not be one. They are meant, they call them nomological network. There are many things that are related. The anxiety related with now to nervousness to depression with another thing. So many things may be related like that. It's just like when we are talking of happiness, is it joy? Some people will tell you that joy is different from happiness. Some people many things are related to our happiness. So I don't know if I've answered that question. So concerning your question, yes, that you talk about the mistake you make, apart from your own method, even your study design. I see somebody that, you know, sometimes when you see people's work, immediately, most of them, when before they come, they have already, some of them have collected data. But you see, by the time you see, okay, what you want, I want to know the what you want to achieve, the name of the study, your objective. By the time you begin to see, from the name and the objective, when you go to study design, sometimes they miss it up. It's wrong study design. Some, the wrong questionnaire, you have already said apart from the two, but the wrong study design can cause it. And even analysis also. If you do wrong analysis, wrong interpretation, you can be telling us something else. It's part of it. You can be telling us something. Some people who do work, the result is there. They don't know how to interpret the result. They say something else, and they conclude different things from what the finding is. They conclude different things. So different aspects of the study can lead to wrong conclusion. So any other question? Any other question? No question. So it's well understood. So you can shut it. I understand now. Okay. Well. Okay. Okay. If there's no question, if you cannot ask, you can just shut it. Okay. If there's no question, let me off the recording.